Welcome to another episode of The Brand Called You, a vodcast and podcast show that brings you leadership lessons, knowledge, experience, and wisdom from hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. I am your host, Ashutosh Garg, and I'm privileged to welcome a friend, a member of the YPO, and a very, very accomplished individual from New York, USA, Meera Teresa Gandhi. Meera, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Ashutosh.
Meera is the founder and CEO of the Giving Back Foundation. She is a TV show host of a show called Three Tips in partnership with the Times Network, where she gives tips on business leadership, fitness, and travel. And she has another TV show, which is the Meera Gandhi Show. So Meera, let's first talk about the Giving Back Foundation. Tell me about this venture and what you do.
Well, the Giving Back Foundation was started in 2010. The idea was to help people get education who didn't have access to it. But the foundation has three mandates. The first is to educate. The second, to be a platform for positive dialogue and debate. So we sponsor different events like the Woodstock Film Festival and various other places where people can come together and offer a good message. And the third is the mental wellness platform, where we put out content to help people live a less stressed out, a more fruitful life through advice brought from other experts in the field.
Mm-hmm. And, when I was reading about you, you say that we are to the universe only as much as we give back to it. Help me and all our viewers and listeners understand this comment along with an example or an anecdote.
Well, it's very clear that we live in a very symbiotic world. Mm-hmm. We breathe in oxygen and we breathe out carbon dioxide. So on a very basic level, the universe has shown us that this is the way the planet has to function. So if we are just takers, after a while, we are not really in sync with the universe. In order to be in sync with the universe, in order to be part of the universe, we have to be able to give something. And in giving something to the universe, we find our own calling and our own mission, and we get completely connected to the universe. So that's how I coined the phrase, we are to the universe only as much as we give back to it. You give more, you get more connected, you get more engaged, you live the journey more passionately. That's going to be your journey on the planet.
Fascinating. So, again, you started giving back very, very early in life. I mean, when I was reading about you, you started giving back in school. What was your motivation and what made you start the Giving Back Foundation?
I think some of us have a sort of a karuna or a kindness or a giving nature that is within us. We are born with it. Some of us are lucky that was noticed and sort of nurtured along the way by especially my mother. Mm-hmm. And at the age of 16, I was at Ashadan on a Rotary project where we had to go for a certain amount of community hours and bathe the handicapped kids and wash them and feed them and put them into bed. And I enjoyed that Saturday so much. Mm-hmm. I went back every single Saturday on the bus to Baikala in Bombay for the last 2 years of high school because it gave me a lot of joy, and I had gotten to know the children by name and who they were and who they are and what they love and what they don't love, and it was a very rewarding experience. Mm-hmm. And I was fortunate to meet Mother Teresa many times during that phase. Mm-hmm. And I got to know Mother Teresa very well and work with her, helping her bathe kids, talking to her, kneeling with her, saying the rosary with her. Mm-hmm. It was a very blessed time.
Wow. So, in the last 11 years, you have built a very, very powerful brand, the Giving Back Foundation. A lot of people have foundations. You are known, talked about. My question to you is, what goes into building a strong philanthropy brand?
I think the first thing that goes into building a brand is that it's the quality of the work. Like, what really are you doing? What is the Giving Back Foundation doing? Is it reaching out to people? Is it changing their lives in any way? Even if you're hosting one event for, say, the last year of FIT students, where you bring in someone from Estee Lauder, Revlon, Givenchy, this is the second mandate, being a platform for dialogue and debate. And these girls, they talk to someone from Estee Lauder, and one of them gets a job at Estee Lauder. Another one's talking to someone from Givenchy and gets a job there. Mm. Well, for those 150 children who came to the One Platform event that we sponsored, it was life-changing because it started their careers. Mm. So I think one is it's got to have a real impact. It's got to be real. The second is people have to have trust in it. And the trust really is top-down. Do they trust Meera Gandhi? Is she trustworthy? Is she bringing the best projects to us? Are we in a safe space? Is the money being used well? Is the money being used to the last penny? I think all these things are very important. Mm. And then when people start to understand what you're doing, they jump on the wagon and they write about it, or they ask you to come on panels and they ask you to chair things and they ask you to speak about it and they ask you to guide and advise and mentor. And it has a sort of snowball effect. And the snowball just starts getting bigger and bigger. But it really does start with how relevant is what you're doing? Is it real? And is it making a real impact? Mm.
And the converse of that question is, what have been your challenges as you have built the foundation?
I think for me, in the recent years, the biggest challenge has been since I got divorced. I got divorced in 2014. My ex-husband, who was a very successful banker on Wall Street, used to... We've only put our own personal family money into this. So it was very well funded. But since I got divorced, I've been trying to raise funds and I haven't been very successful in doing that. So I've been putting my own money into it, which of course is depleting very fast. Mm-hmm. And I've been trying to really keep the balls up in the air. Mm-hmm. But we have come up with other ideas, creative ideas. We have launched a line of products, which we hope will bring a lot of money back to the foundation. The idea of the products is to raise money for the foundation. So we have some creative ideas. We did do a TV show that made some money and it went back into the foundation. We did a book called The Giving Back Book. It was $50, a coffee table book. The entire proceeds went to the foundation. Mm. So we are looking at creative ways to raise money for the foundation. But I think this has been a bit of a challenge, but it hasn't stopped me because you can do a lot of things without a lot of money as well, if you're just creative and if your heart is in the right space. There are always people who will come forward to help sponsor or to walk the path with us. Mm-hmm. I mean, during COVID, there haven't been so many on-ground activities, obviously, because everything was shut down. But the St. Michael's School continued and I funded it. And we've successfully come through it the last 2 years, which I'm very proud of. Amazing. And now everything's opening up and we're looking very closely at how we will take this brand of 20 products and really blow it open. Mm.
And you want to talk a little bit about these 20 products for our viewers and listeners?
Oh, I would love to. Mm. So we have the Giving Back fragrance, which is amazing. It has 28 ingredients, patchouli, lavender, thyme, Zanzibar, daffodils, rose, sandalwood. Mm-hmm. And the idea of this fragrance is that it's uplifting as well as calming. And we want people to be in a beautiful space when they use it. Mm. We have the body bath gel shampoo, the soap. We also have an eye cream, which is fantastic. Mm-hmm. We have a diffuser with the bamboo, the bamboo diffusers. And then going forward, we will also add one or two ancillary products, which will be in the healthcare area.
Terrific. So, an interesting segue to my next question is giving in America. And, when I was serving on the board of Gavi, we used to see who are the major countries that really give large amounts of money. In the US, people give away or give back a lot of their wealth. When do you think people in India, and I'm only talking to you about USA and India, when do you think the spirit of giving back will come to India?
Well, I get asked this question a lot. Mm-hmm. And in the US, the way the system is set up, it's set up to get a tax deduction. So if I give $1 million tax deduction, mm-hmm. I get that $1 million deducted from my taxes. Okay. So I'm not saying everyone does it for taxes, but there's a huge incentive. I can do good. Why would I just write a check to the government? Mm-hmm. That's one way people look at it. Some people have a genuine heart of giving and they want to give back. Great. In India, the situation is that now, of course, 1% corporate social responsibility, if that is disbursed, it will be tax deductible. I know that many companies are availing of this and doing programs, very good. However, in India, people have been a bit suspicious because they've given money to organizations. People have run away. Mm. They go to the place and office doesn't exist. Mm. The end receiver never receives the money and people are tired of that. In India, people give to their temples, to their religious organization.
Correct.
And they feel, okay, I went to Tirupati and I already gave 50 lakhs. So, you know, I've given back. A lot of people who have staff, they help, they get their the children of the staff married. They often buy them shoes. They send them to school. They're doing it on a more nuclear level. Mm. So that is their way of giving back. I mean, most of the staff in India don't even have healthcare. Correct. If you're sick, what do? You go to your boss. Mera beta bimar hai. Achha, chalo. Driver ke saath aspatal usko le jao. Okay, you're taken care of. So people are counting that as part of giving back.
Well,
but on this front, I will say that even the R&D, because I have a lot of friends who are like you in the pharmaceutical business, they're very frustrated that boards don't want to okay money for R&D, and you need to have R&D to produce better goods for humanity and better medicine. So I think until there is trust, this will be difficult. Having said that, Nimish Kampani wrote quite a nice check to the Giving Back Foundation in India. Mm. And simply because he knew that he was giving it to me, and he knew that every penny would go to St. Michael's, and he has an office in Delhi, and he was very kind. He sent someone of the office to St. Michael's to see where the money was used. We had built a small auditorium. Mm. We had finished the gardens, and he was very pleased to see that. So I think when that sort of trust comes back, Indians are now rich. They will give, but no one wants to waste their money or have it thugged away.
Okay. Very well said. So, you know, again, you just spoke about the St. Michael School for Girls in New Delhi, and I know you give them a lot of your support. Tell me about what kind of support you give them and what have been some of your learnings?
Well, the St. Michael School, basically my mother used to visit them as a volunteer. It's on the backside of where my parents' house is in Delhi. Mm-hmm. It's in Bhogal Market. Mm-hmm. And so the first I started with giving them small checks. Then I understood what they needed. So over the years, we have basically helped them soup to nuts. Mm-hmm. We put in a whole new kitchen. There used to be one kerosene stove, which used to cook three meals a day. The girls had to wait forever to get their food. Mm-hmm. Now we've put in a proper kitchen. We got a gas line. Believe you me, just getting the gas lines connected, we had to go through hoops to get so many different certificates. It's done. So we have a beautiful kitchen with refrigerators. We can freeze stuff. We have space for fresh stuff. We've added pipes with filtered water. We put in filtration systems. Mm-hmm. We have added the auditorium. The grounds were completely broken up. I do have a film which shows how the grounds used to be. Now the grounds are, they look better than Lodhi Gardens with flowers. The kids lie there and do their homework. Mm-hmm. The roads are tarred. They have a minibus to take the kids to school. We have surveillance cameras so that the girls are safe. The doors can be locked at night. They have a computer room. I connected them with a school in London, in Mayfair. So they have this computer interactive session with the school in Mayfair every Thursday. The girls in Mayfair love it. Our girls in Bhogal love it. It's just a great program. A school in New York got involved. Their athletic team raised some money for supplies for their garden. And so we took that whole big check. We have a picture with the girls and the check. Mm-hmm. And then of course we changed it to rupees and gave it to them. So many people are getting involved in it. But of course, for me, it's the mainstay, the food, the shelter, the heating, bed sheets, extra blankets, painting, maintenance. You know what goes into managing a whole
Absolutely.
Establishment.
And most importantly, look at the kind of lives you are changing for these girls who are studying there and going out to become young women.
It's one person at a time, one moment at a time.
Absolutely. So one more question relating to the Giving Back Foundation before I move to your TV programs. This is the age, Meera, of the millennials and the Gen Zs. And, you know, you have three children. My both my sons are millennials. There's a very big difference in the way they look at giving back. So my question to you is, what is your experience of working with millennials when it comes to philanthropy?
Well, the one thing I will say is there are three ways that millennials and Gen Z look at giving back. The first is they're always happy to volunteer their time, even though they're very busy, for a good cause. Second is when they consume consciously. They're looking at the brands. Is this brand giving back? Is this brand saving the planet? Is it just another multinational trying to make money off of me? Is this brand, while it's bettering my life, make the life of someone else's life better? The third is they are looking at a self-sustaining planet. So they are moving into renovated warehouses. They are not going to cut, they're not going to developers of cutting more stone or digging more or creating more sand. They're going to developers, you can see that in Williamsburg, Brooklyn, Bushwick, anywhere, and saying, hey, here's an old warehouse that used to be a store that's abandoned for years. How do we remove the asbestos? How do we fix it up? How do we use the old containers from shipping? And how do we, you know, use this to create a sustainable living for the next generations? Many millennials are also building things on the rooftop. One is it cools the building. You don't have to use so much air conditioning. Second, it uses space. And third, it's another way of just creating your own food and reducing the chain from the farming to the supermarket to the end user. And I think it's working extremely well.
Very nice. So now let me move to the next segment about your avatar as a TV host. You know, you've got two separate shows. One is the Meera Gandhi Show and the other one is Three Tips. Tell me about both these shows and what motivated you to start.
Well, the Meera Gandhi Show started really as an idea to look at what is the way, is there a formula? Is there a way to live a more fruitful journey, a happier journey? If so, what are those qualities that make us all happy? Because we're all basically the same. So we started with unconditional love because too much is talked about love, that you have to love someone, they have to love you. It's almost a selfish way of looking at love. Love is unconditional. It should fill you and you should do it with nothing in return. It should be non-transactional. You don't expect anything from it. And that's the best way to get happiness. Then we started to identify together, what is happiness? Happiness is that feeling of, you know, being in peace, feeling good. And this is important because this journey goes really fast. I mean, if you are with people who are in their older years and you see how they're trying to hold on to every breath, you understand how precious life is. And I do have an older parent who is, you know, who's holding on to every breath. And it makes me understand that life is a very, a very precious journey.
Very true.
And so we, in our youth, we can't be so ill-advised or unconscious that we don't realize it. And we wait till the end of our life and say, oh my God, I had this great years. Why didn't I do it? So that was the purpose of it. And it was very well received. It also showed again in the UAE and it continues to be viewed. My idea on Three Tips was to do something short and snappy. When we first started with Times TV, the idea was it would show below the news, do the ticker. Okay, three tips for wellness today. Okay, three tips for being happy today. Three tips of finding a rainbow. Smile, try to look around you, try to leave a place better than you found it. So that the idea of 1 minute bites came about with three tips. And then that sort of evolved in a book, and we are going to have a book going forward, which is hopefully going to be released very soon. I hope the publishers are listening because we need to really tighten up and get it out. But we're definitely doing it. I think it will be useful. And at the end of the day, it's nothing earth-shattering, but it's nice to be reminded, hey, okay, life did come with a book, which is in here, but sometimes we can't access it. It would be nice to have something here to just remind me and help me and make my life, like, I don't know, a little more joyful.
Very well said. So, Meera, I'm now going to move to the last segment of our conversation. Our young audience loves to get to know my guest a little better. So I have a few questions that I say are personal questions.
Sure.
My first question is that in a life so well lived, done so many different things, built an amazing foundation, what would you say are three key milestones or pivots in your life or your career?
I think the three key milestones are when I was very young, in the fourth standard, there was a talent show I hadn't prepared, but one of the teachers said, well, you know, we need one more person. Why don't you go on stage and sing? Mm. And I did, and I won it. And I first understood the feeling of adulation and what it was like to be on stage, and I liked it. And my parents were so happy. The second was when I became head girl of school, and then I went on to be head girl of Cathedral and head girl of Jesus Mary College at Delhi University. I understood leadership was one of my talents. Mm-hmm. And the third was after having my three kids, I think I understood that nurturing, I think my kids have done extremely well, nurturing, mentoring, it's been one of the most joyful things I've done is raise my kids. I think these three sort of, I don't know if we can call them milestones, but these three sort of things, for lack of a better word, have been important to me. And I think they have sort of made me understand who I am as a person. And that's been easy for me to identify my mission of serving, my mission of speaking out, and my mission of wanting to be there for people and being excited about that.
Well, thank you. You almost answered my next question, which is, what are some of the core values you believe in?
I think my core values are very clear, that one has to have their own inner moral compass and stick with it no matter what. I think that's very important. Telling the truth is very important to me. Having a sense of humor is important. I mean, I laugh. I mean, I still fall. It's crazy. But having a sense of humor is important. And I don't know if this can be a quality, but Deepak Chopra believes in it greatly. It's this resilience, this thing of letting go. Something that didn't work out, let it go and be resilient to move on to the next thing. Right. Because in the next moment, the universe has infinite number of options open for you. So when we remember that, we just don't get stuck. I tell anyone listening, if you're in a place where you think you're stuck, get unstuck. It's not worth it, because the next moment and the moment after, there's freedom. We are only keeping ourselves stuck. But what the universe is offering us is freedom, opportunity to go forth and to enjoy life.
Terrific. So I have time for two more questions for you. My next question to you is that, from where you are today, as you look back, what does success mean to Meera?
I think success has really been raising my three kids flawlessly. Mm-hmm. Never had any issues with health or drugs. They were excellent in school. They are now leaders in their own right. Kabir was, a Harvard. He was the Latin commencement orator at graduation. Never happens. Kiran is now a Madam Gandhi. She is a very well-known artist, singer, musician, drummer, and really commands her audiences all over the world. Kanika, she is working for the Organic Trade Food Commission to make sure we have more organic food, and they're all thriving. So I think the way the children have turned out, I feel is a success. I feel the fact that I am able to walk into any country in the world and be at home is a success. From now till I die, I basically provide it for myself. I'm in a very good physical, mental, financial, healthy situation. If something happens tomorrow, we'll figure it out. So I live without fear. And the other big part of success is to know that you can take people with you and you can help change their lives and help them with their lives. And I think that's a very big part of success, because success is lonely at the top. For me, success is to meet anybody and say, hey, you know what? Yes, I can help you in some way or the other. Yes, I can, because I am so okay And I'm so not looking for anything more for myself. Mm-hmm. I have all the space mm-hmm. and knowledge and ability to help you. Wonderful. To me, that's a very big part of being successful.
Terrific. And my last question to you, and this is a follow-up question to success. Who or what inspires you?
I think my mother and my father inspire me. They mm-hmm. are just, they really understand discipline, hard work. They have a sense of humor. Mm. They don't take anything too seriously. They live well. I think my children inspire me. My team at the foundation inspires me. Mm. The way they work, the things they tell me. I think people in the news inspire me. Now there's so many. I mean, I think Sherry Blair is a dear friend of mine. I think the way Sherry Blair conducts herself with a no-nonsense attitude inspires me. I think Hillary Clinton inspires me. I think Mother Mary inspires me. Jesus inspires me. I think the mystics inspire me. I think Sadhguru inspires me. Mm-hmm. Deepak Chopra, I listen to his meditations every night. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of people that inspire me. Mm-hmm. Swami Paramahansa Yogananda. Mm-hmm. I keep reading this book and I'm inspired over and over and over
Absolutely.
Again.
Absolutely. Well, you and I share the inspiration from Swami, from autobiography of a yogi. So
the best. Absolutely. The best.
Absolutely. But Meera, thank you so much. It's been such a pleasure speaking to you. Thank you for taking me down this incredible journey of the Giving Back Foundation and all your TV shows. Thank you again and good luck.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for listening to the Brand Called You videocast and podcast, a platform that brings you knowledge, experience, and wisdom of hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. Do visit our website, www.tbcy.in, to watch and listen to the stories of many more individuals. You can also follow us on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Just search for the brand called You.